In this video, we will be doing close-up and macro shooting with the Nikon Coolpix P610. While you can use nearly any mode with the Coolpix P610 for doing close-up photography, we'll be selecting the programmed auto mode. Next, we have to select the focusing mode. We use the rotary multi-selector for this. Press the bottom of it and select the macro close-up focusing mode. When close-up mode is ready for focusing, the flower indicator will turn green. You can also use scene mode to do close-ups. Select scene mode. In scene mode, press the menu button and then select close-up mode. In scene close-up mode, you have two possible selections. One is normal single shot, and the other is noise reduction burst. In normal single shot, the camera shoots one frame when you press the shutter release. In noise reduction burst, the camera shoots multiple shots while the shutter release is held down and makes the best possible shot. We'll choose single shot. There are some other modes that I typically set the camera to. Image quality, I'm going to set to fine. I'll set the ISO to 400. That'll let us use a high enough shutter speed without creating too much noise. I'll set metering to center weighted. Typically, the subject is near the center of the lens when we're doing macro work. I set autofocus area mode to manual normal, and this gives me control over where I want the camera to focus in autofocus mode. I also set zoom memory to on, and this lets me see what the level of zoom is when I'm changing zoom level. When you have zoom level memory on, you can see the level of zoom as you change the zoom. And if you exceed the close-up focus mode, the flower turns white. Another indicator shown when you have zoom memory on is a small triangle which shows the zoom level for the closest possible focus point. One of the things you want to do when you're shooting macros is determine what the widest field is so you know how big of an object you can get in that field. So we'll put this in close-up macro focus mode and adjust the camera position so we can check the width of the field when we shoot the photo. Wait for the flower to turn green and shoot. We created this frame at the closest possible distance that the camera can focus. The frame width is about 4.8 centimeters. And it turns out that whether we're in the scene mode or just macro close-up focus mode, the frame width will be about the same. Sometimes repeated attempts to use automatic focus will fail, and you'll have to switch to manual focus when you're trying to get the closest focus that you can. At these times, it's nice to have the side zoom button changed to focus mode rather than zoom mode. You'll be able to focus very closely with zoom, just as you do with automatic focus, and the field will be about the same. It turns out that whether you're using the scene mode for close-ups, whether you're using close-up macro focus mode, or whether you're using manual mode, the field width at your closest focus point is about the same. So what kind of photos can we get using the close-up macro mode in the Coolpix P610? Using the closest focus point we can get. Here's a wasp, and I've removed the background just to help visualize it a little better. As you can see, the detail is pretty good. Even though the width of the Wasp is much less than the field width of the P610, the camera has enough pixels that we can zoom in quite a ways without losing a lot of detail and retain good quality photos. Here's another shot of a bug. I'll zoom in a little more. One of the problems with shooting macros is the problem of lighting the subject. I tend to use the 105mm zoom area so that I can keep the camera back, and it's a lot easier to light the subject without creating shadows from the camera. If you want more extreme macros, you might have to use some add-on macro lenses like the ones that I'll show now. This is the Raynox DCR-250 lens set. It comes as two parts. One is the lens, and the other is the mount to connect to the camera lens. The lens is screwed into the lens mount, and then the lens mount is mounted on the camera by squeezing the buttons on the side of the mount and placing it on the lens of your camera and releasing the buttons. When the buttons are released, there are two grippers with teeth that grab onto the threaded area of your lens. I'm attaching the DCR-250 to my camera with a filter attached. If you attach with no filter, be sure your camera is off so that you're not binding the housing when the camera opens and closes. To attach, simply squeeze in the buttons on the side all the way, at least for this lens, and then release and let them snap into your lens. Using the Raynox DCR-250, your field width will go from about 4.8 centimeters to about 4 millimeters. So instead of this image, you get this image. The DCR-250 can be used at nearly any zoom level, but at the lower zoom levels, you'll find considerable vignetting, and even some vignetting up to the 135 mark. As you zoom the camera more and more, the field narrows, and the focusing distance increases from your subject. That makes lighting a little easier with this lens on. Here are the camera zoom levels, focus distances, and field widths for your camera when the DCR-250 is attached. One of the problems you run into when doing macro work is that you have very little depth of field, as you can see in this photograph, where the compound eye of the Wasp is in fairly good focus, but the rest of it isn't. I modified my camera slider to make a focusing rail. With that, I can shoot multiple photos and stack them together using a technique called focus stacking. I shot 20 pictures. Only a few are reproduced here, and the camera was set on time exposure for 30-second intervals, and each time the camera shot a frame, the track caused the camera to move about a half a millimeter forward. The merged frame has much more of the Wasp head in focus than any one of the frames that were used in the stack to create the final image. One of the tools that's pretty valuable for making macro photographs is a focusing rail. It allows you to move the camera in small increments without disturbing it too much. I hope with this video I've encouraged you to shoot more macro work, and I also hope that I've introduced you to some new techniques for shooting macro photographs. If you've enjoyed this video, please subscribe to my channel, and thank you for viewing.